Okay, might as well get started so that we're not here through tomorrow. The first thing I want to say is I am in total awe of the incredible second language speakers here at all levels. I can't get over it. You guys, what you have accomplished and what you continue to accomplish is just mind-boggling. It's just absolutely staggering. And, you know, just a short while ago, nobody would have ever dreamed this could happen with these languages. It's amazing. I'm always just going to be in awe. I mean, I've always felt that way about the languages themselves and certainly about first language speakers, but what you guys are doing at all levels is just unbelievable and amazing. I should say, too, that I know that there's a variety of experiences here, and so sort of what's the right thing for some of you is not the right thing for others. So if you're kind of new at this kind of thing, don't worry about it. Just sit back and let it wash over you and get what you can get. And if you're very sophisticated, and there's some very sophisticated people here, don't let me insult you by acting like I think you don't know it, because I know you do. Okay. So, as we all know, that for language programs, there are a lot of variety of desires and a lot of goals, and what's right for one group is you know, different from what's right for the next group and for individuals, and they're all important, and it sort of makes sense to go with your own goals at the moment. Obviously, one big piece of a language program is community identity and solidarity. And that's really, really important. And if you just get that far, that's great. And I think everybody here is actually at that point. And there are ways to do that. Okay, you can go up a level, and you can equip people with patterns for creating new things that nobody ever told them. Okay, and they can be good speakers doing new things. Okay, that's up a level. That takes years and years, but okay. And you can go even further, and we'll look at what you might do if you're going even further, looking at the really, really fine points about what's special about your language. We'll do that. Okay, so the first kind of thing, as you all know so very well, what makes you really want to learn a language is if you hear it around you. Okay, so if it's never around, yeah, you know, I don't need to know Greek, okay. But if it's there, you want it. And so obviously what you want to do is fill the air with language. How do you do that? Okay, sagum, skeno, okay, unikiwahe, or whatever, you know, okay, yawegum, yawegum, depending on where you're from, you would spell it one way or another. Okay, ogao, okay. And as Tracy was saying this morning, you might want to choose your listeners for not being very judgmental. this works really well, kind of gets you up to speed. You might say, you know, Zadja, okay, or you might spell it Zadja if you're from Ganasadage or Gathawage, or well, not if you're from Akwesasne, you will say Zadja. If you're Sean, okay. Or you might say Sagyan, or you might say Sadyan if you're speaking Cayuga, okay. Zardat, okay, Zatun, Zatgarhatov, Zatgar, okay, you got this. Dajena, or Dadzena, okay, okay. Dasatgarhadeni. This is exactly what Tom was talking about before, but, you know, you can get dogs to do it, and they don't get bored. Zenasquio, okay. Okay. Okay, so that's level one. Then, and I would say for level one, an obvious thing that I think you're all doing is pay attention to what people say on a daily basis in any language. So listen to what thing people are saying in English the most often, and go for those things to say in the language, because that's going to be most useful, obviously. Okay, next level, which you're already doing, is this empowerment. That is, if you, again, show people how to fish, it's better than handing them a fish. Okay, so for Mohawk, and this is sort of in the theme of the conference for several days, you can say yawegum if you're from the West. Yawegunga, okay? And so you do enough of these, and people can sort of figure out, as Tom was saying, okay, I can put gung on there, and I've got a question. Yoganorum, okay? Everybody, you can see what that would be, right? If you want to say, is it raining? Yeah, yoganorum, okay? Or if you're from the East, you would spell it like that, but you'd say it about the same way, okay? And then there's other things you can do. So you can, if you know this, okay, and then you know this, okay, and if you know this, maybe you've heard this before, I don't know, okay, and you know this, and then you hear, can you imagine how you would say she has eaten it if you know this much? Yeah. Ta-da! Okay, this is a kind of empowerment. So a good teacher doesn't necessarily even have to say, okay, this is the masculine singular patient form, which we use with stative verbs, okay. The teacher can say, okay, here's how you say, you know, or you can do it, you know, all gone. And you just fill the air with enough of these patterns, and people pick it up. And some people pick it up unconsciously, some people pick it up, you know, sort of intellectually. And the nice thing about teaching, I mean, kids, you know, if you stage things right, they're going to pick it up without thinking about it. Adults, some people do that the best. Some people, it can really help you if somebody gives you a little rule. For example, somebody says, oh, by the way, for a falling tone in Mohawk, you know, if your syllable ends in a glottal stop and it's stressed, that pulls the tone down, you know. Ding, you've got a million things to do right. Okay, we were talking about this last night. Or if you're Tuscarora, you know, and you say, you know, if your stressed syllable ends in an N or an R or a W or a Y, that pulls the tone down. All of a sudden, your pronunciation is miles better, okay? Or if you're Cayuga, you say, okay, you know, your syllable ends in an H, and you're counting from the beginning, odd, even, odd, even, odd, even, odd, odd. Okay, whisper it, okay? That's really good, and you can sort of, that can really help you. Obviously, this isn't something you want to spend time asking first language speakers about. So you don't want to say, okay, Mr. Cayuga speaker, what's your rule for devoicing vowels? Nah. They know it, but they don't know it on that level, and it would be a waste of time to ask them. Okay, so rules and patterns are really, really powerful because they let you soar. They let you say things that you've never said before. And that can take a lot of time. But there's also something more. Say we want to go to the next level. Okay? A big piece of this heritage you have as a language is words. It's not just rules. Okay? And what are words? Well, basically, you know, if you think about sort of the world, you've got this kaleidoscope of experience. And what a language does is recognize, put it into pieces, into concepts, into ideas. And those are the words. Okay? And different languages do it different ways. I mean, you already know this. So in one language, you've got one word for this. And then the next language over, there isn't a word for this. There's a word for this and for that. And then there's this other word, and there's not even, okay. So this is a big piece. It's actually what words exist. And speakers, first language speakers, know which words exist. They also know which words could exist but don't exist. Okay, this is a delicate distinction, but it's very, very real. I know as somebody who has, you know, been participating in a conversation and saying something, and people look at me and smile, and maybe some of you had this experience. And I think, okay, what did I do wrong? Odd, even, first of all, you know, yeah. I'll say, okay, what did I do wrong? They say, oh, you didn't do anything wrong. Say, nobody ever said that before, okay? And I know that that's really important. So the difference between what people know is part of the language and what could exist but hasn't been done yet, that's a big piece of heritage, and it's something you don't want to lose. So, some of these rules that we learn are always going to work, and you can know, if I've got this rule, I can use it every single time, and I'm going to come up with something real and good. And then there's other stuff, it's patterns and it's rules, and if you know that, you can understand something new that you've never heard before. But don't, as we were saying last night, don't do this at home, kids, because you might end up with something that is not part of the language. So another big piece of sort of cutting edge stuff is knowing which rules are going to get you good stuff, and you can always count on them, and which rules you might want to play with on your own. Okay. So in English, we've got predictable patterns. So if you're an English speaker, you've got dog and dogs, and if you're, you know, you've got name, we know that we've got name, and this is a famous one people use. Okay, so you know this thing about wug, you know what a wug is? Okay, maybe you do and maybe you don't, okay? But if you've got two of them, you've got two wugs, okay? You know, okay? Okay, in English we've got entertain and we've got entertainment. Okay, we can do that. Amuse, amusement. Govern, government. Okay, we got a pattern going here. Civilize. Oh, whoa. But it was working so well. You know what happened? Okay. No, it's civilization. Oh, okay. Maybe it's the eyes. Okay. Criticize. Whoops. No. How come? It's just not that way. Okay. So basically, when you're sort of looking to really leave a good record of the language and really speak well, you don't want to do these kinds of things. Okay, you want to do the WUGS stuff, but you want to be aware of these kinds of things and know the difference. Okay, so which ones can you count on? Pronominal prefixes, you can count on those. Okay, not so easy. You know, just master the 60 pronominal prefixes and the 5 different patterns they have depending on what the next stem is and the one before it, you know. Okay, well, if it's an and stem, and if it's something, okay. So it's not so easy, but if you get all those patterns, you're good. You will know what, you know, what a new verb is that you've never heard before. Okay, so for example, oh, here we go again. If we know how to say I did it, okay, in the language, and we've mastered the patterns, we can predict exactly right how to say you did it, he did it, the two of those guys did it, you know, the 3 cows did it, etc. Okay. So for example, Mohawk, Wakadora de. If we know how to say Wakadora de, even if you've never heard you, we know it's Wasadora de. I do that, well, I mean, you hear Hunt all the time, but you would know you're gonna be good, okay? Or Wahadora de, okay? And the same for Cayuga. If you've got Agado Wat, you can know that you're gonna have Asado Wat and Ahado Wat. You know you're gonna be good, and you can just do that forever. You're good if you master all that stuff. Tense. Tom was talking about this morning. If we know the future, I'll do it, we can reliably predict the past. I did it. And also this I would, I should, I could do it. Okay, if you know the rules, it's not like nothing to know the rules, but if you know the patterns, you're good and you can be completely confident. So angadora de, wagadora de, agadora de, or engadowat, agadowat, agadowat, we're good. We know, okay. Some other ones, you've all seen this. You can learn how to ask questions reliably. Negation, we all sort of do this like class 3. Okay, we're good on that. Directions, yeah, If we know the away form, we can predict the toward form. So for example, in Mohawk, if you know that yazadawa is a verb, and it's a good verb, then you just know. You want to say, oh, swim over this way. You know you can create it, even if you've never heard it, and you know it's going to be good. You've got dasadawa. Okay. Same for kyuga. Hatzadawan. Dasadawan. You know it's going to be good. Okay. So these you can count on. Okay. Okay. How about this? This is Mohawk. Yundanak doroks. Okay. Yundanak doroks ta. Okay. Bedspread. Yep. Okay, yuntgutseratsororoks ta. Okay, good. We're good, we're on a roll. Yuntekwahratsororoks. Yuntekwahratsororoks ta. Good. Okay, yuntkunhwaroroks. Okay, how about mask? Whoops. Oh. Well, how come? In this case, there's no how come. It's just not the way it's done. Okay, so this is one of those where if you can understand this, you're going to be able to understand when somebody gives you a new one, but don't try this at home, kids, or you'll be doing the criticization kind of stuff. Okay. Yunoharets, yunoharetahkwa, yaksoharets, yaksoharetahkwa. Okay. Yanosquas. You know squat da qua. No. There's not even a better way to do it. Okay. That's not really a surprise because people needed a word for, you know, washing machine or detergent or dishpan. Who needs a word for what you steal with? You know. Okay. So it never happened, and there's a good reason it never happened. And that's a piece of culture. Okay, Kyuga, same thing. Unwas, okay. Unwakta, okay. Inyadon. Okay, whoops. What happened to my ta? It ended up kwa. How come? No reason, that's just what people did. Okay, so that means if you're a second language speaker, you just want to learn these things, okay? And if somebody springs a new one on you, you know what's going on, but don't do it at home, kids, okay? Uhong ka. How about uhong kwa? No, it doesn't exist. Okay, if you forced a first language speaker to say, what does that mean? I suspect they would say, it's not a word. But if it were, here's what it would mean. Okay, and that's a delicate thing you want to kind of keep in mind, because it's a piece of heritage. So kind of always be thinking of civilizement and criticization. Okay, idiomaticity is a big deal, especially for Iroquoian. And basically, there are a lot of ways you can say something. Say you've got an idea. There are a lot of ways you could say it, and there are probably a lot of grammatical ways you could say it. Okay. But speakers know which one is part of the language and which one isn't part of the language. And this is a delicate but really crucial piece of heritage. Okay? I'll play this for you people who are good Mohawk speakers. Oh, you didn't hear much of that. Okay. So, how would you say, so how's everything? Okay, think about it. In your language, it doesn't matter which language it is. Okay, you can kind of imagine. So how did he say it? This was part of a conversation. They were running around doing stuff. So he says, gwe, okay. Hatsgwe, oh, niyot. Okay, is that what you would have said? Maybe. Okay, so how do you know you're supposed to say hatsgwe, and how do you say, you know, okay? Well, it's just what he did, okay? Here's another one. How do you say I agree? Okay, mentally think about how you say I agree. And here's what she said. Negit wahi. Okay. Yeah, so you could have said, I agree with a verb, but that's not what she chose to say. And this is what people say a lot. Okay. Here's some idiomaticity. Okay, so what you doing? Okay, that's what you might expect. Okay, what's an answer? Oh, nothing much. Okay, think about how you'd say, oh, nothing much. Okay, where's my cursor? There it is. How did he say it?
Oh, yeah, you're gonna what's the code now?
Is it, oh, nothing much? No. Okay, which part's the nothing and which, okay. Okay. There's a difference, right? This is what gets to Darla's point and other people's point about translation. And it's a question about what you want to sort of cherish and pass on of this thing. So going up to the next level, so we've got all our rules and stuff, and that's really important. If you want to get anywhere, you want to know that if you're an adult. But if you want to go to the next level, you want to know what's special about these languages. How, you know, what's the soul of these languages that makes them different from English and Spanish and German and, you know, French? Well, if every language was the same, okay, why would we need any other ones? You know, the value of each one would not be worth much. I mean, okay, maybe it's nice to be able to say hello in your language. But as you know, there's a lot more. What's special about these languages? Okay, well, you all know about this. Let us count the ways. Okay, now, if you're a Mohawk speaker, listen to this sentence. Okay, see how it sounds to you. See if you notice anything about it.
Okay,
it's really clear. Good Mohawk? You think he's a first language speaker? He is. He's a really good first language speaker. Here's what it looks like. I'll play it again so you can see it.
Etone nerunutio yasakoteri wanyeta nerangueta sua ne am tahune ne runundio sakuyu ugua ne ratigora tanune sumadia tanune.
Okay. Anything funny about it? He's really a good speaker, and he has such beautiful pronunciation. Actually, he's even got an old form. I don't know if any of you picked up on it, but this used to have a glottal stop here. That's what gave you the falling tone, and he's still got a little bit of a glottal stop, so it's really nice. Okay, so no problems, right? We're good. Well, if you know what you're doing, it's immediately clear that the guy's a first language speaker, but that this didn't start out in Mohawk. This is a translation. It's a translation from the Bible, a piece of Daniel, okay? And it's immediately obvious. It's grammatically, it's flawless. The pronunciation is flawless. He's a good language speaker. This was translated by a group of speakers who are very, very good first language speakers. Really just sort of command the whole thing. They're right up there at the pinnacle. But, you know, you look at this, you say, no, didn't start out in Mohawk. Can you figure out how come? I don't know if anybody can figure out how come. Like if he had just been sitting there and you said, so, you know, what did Daniel do? Or something like that. He wouldn't have said this. Okay, well, how come? One is word order. So a lot of you know that know about word order. So what's English word order? Like if you're making a sentence, you're telling somebody who's not very good at English yet, okay, what order do you put the words in? You kind of know this. Okay. The dog chased the cat. Okay. The dog ate. Okay. Well, we know you put the subject first and then you put the verb. Then if you have an object, you put that there. So we've got a really strong word order in English. We call it SVO, subject, verb, object. We're good. Okay. What happens in English if you move the words around? Whoops. Okay. What happens in Mohawk if you move the words around? Okay. Well, let's look at the Mohawk again. This is the one you just saw. Okay, what's the word order here? Well, you could say, okay, you got subject, verb, object, 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 object. It's good, it's the same. Is it the same? It's the same in a translation. Okay. Well, actually, if you look at let people really talk, it doesn't go by subject, verb, object. It goes by whatever is most important. That's what you put first. Okay, and this is true for each of the languages. It's not just Mohawk. It's Tuscarora, as you guys know, and Cayuga and Onondaga, etc. Okay, you may wonder what this has to do with anything. Okay, here's some Mohawk. They were talking about what Gothnawaga was like in the old days. And he was talking about this place back there, and he said, they used to, you know, people, you know, had these things. And he said, oh yeah, they'd breed chickens, wouldn't they? Okay, what's the word order here? Okay, there's the object verb. Okay, what? How come the object went first? Well, he's talking about chickens. The most important thing isn't animal making. It's chickens, you know, there were chickens back there. Okay, this is why the object is first. Then he says, maybe remember the house is still there behind what's her name's house, there's still a house. And then he said this, I'll play it for you. Okay. There, that's where the chickens used to live. Okay, now look, the chickens are down here at the end. These chickens. How come they're at the end? They were up here to start with. It has nothing to do with being subjects or objects. It's that up here, this is the first time we'd heard about the chickens, and they were really important. By the time we got down here, we were already thinking about chickens. You didn't have to say, chickens! They used to live there. The big point is, that's where they lived, those chickens. Okay. This is good. This is real Iroquoian word order. Okay. What does that have to do with it? Reg Henry was talking about how to hunt pike. Okay. And so he was talking about how people do it. And he says, everybody does it a different way. Some people do it like this. This is how I do it. So he said, well, that's how I did it. But there was this yahta, and this is how he used to do it. Okay, here he's coming. Did I put, yeah, he's first. How come he's first? It's because he's bringing in this whole new character. So he's, well, I used to do it like this, I do it like this, I do this. But you know, there was this guy, and he's bringing, this is the most important thing. This is how he did it, okay, and the how he did it, we're always talking about how things are done. He used to tell me how he did it. Okay, there's the verb down there, okay? So there's this long, he's telling all about hunting fish and how people do it and all this kind of stuff. He's, fish have good eyes, you know. Okay, here's how he said it. There are the fish over there. How come they're over here after the verb? Well, because we've been talking about fish this whole time, okay? The new idea is, watch out, they have good eyesight. They're going to see you in the water, okay? So this is the news. They have good eyesight. The fish, yeah, that's old stuff. And so he's very carefully managing the order of his words here. Okay, he says, well, that's how I do it. I hunt where I can see into the water because I have sharp eyes. That's, in fact, why I kill a lot of fish. Okay, how did he say I kill a lot of fish?
Oh, he's a good man, toss it on that.
Okay. Okay, now the fish are at the end. Because he's been spending all this time talking about fish. Okay, the news is lots. Okay, so this is old news, the fish. The lots is new news and the important part. Okay. When it's moving around, it's easy to spear. This was all in Cayuga, of course. You'll shoot it if you have a gun. Okay, so where's he going to put the have and the gun and stuff like that? Okay, now the gun is in front. This is the first time he's mentioned a gun. He was talking about people spearing things and all this kind of stuff. But he said, hey, you know, if you have a gun, this is what you do. Okay, so the gun is the new information. So basically, this is huge. I mean, where you put your words is a big, big deal. And in English, it's pretty cut and dried. You know, you put your subject and then verb, and then you have an object, you put that. Okay. Iroquoian speakers are always tuned in to exactly the state of mind of their listeners, what they already know, what's going to be interesting, what's kind of incidental. And they're moving their words exactly to reflect the current thoughts of their listeners. This is huge. I mean, this is a really big cultural difference. Okay, what about words? Okay, so back we are to our Mohawk. Okay, remember this. Okay, whoops, I'll go back up there one more time. Think about kinds of words. Okay, so we've got the king, and we've got his officials, and the princes, that's the children of his children, the king. The governors, the lieutenant governors, we've got a verb here, ordered and come together. Okay, if you ever sort of were in elementary school or junior high school or middle school or whatever, and maybe you remember with kind of dread when people were telling you about grammar and they were talking about prepositions and maybe, I don't know, gerunds, and you think, yeah, you know, thanks, you know. So what kinds of words are there in English? And you think, oh, wow, there's adverbs and there's, what are they? Okay, nice thing about Iroquoian languages, if you look inside of Iroquoian and you're not standing outside in English and saying, okay, what's an adverb and what's a preposition and all this kind of stuff. If you really stand inside Iroquoian languages and you look at the structure in terms of Iroquoian, there are just three kinds. And it's very, very clear. We have nouns, we have verbs, and we have particles. And the difference is very, very, very clear. So you see a word, you can tell immediately if it's a noun or a verb or a particle, if you're tuned into the structure. Okay, what do nouns look like? Okay.
Onaste. Onaste.
Okay, you know what that is. Okay, nouns have a very clear structure. They have a prefix on the front that tells you it's neuter. They have a thing on the back that tells you it's a noun. Okay, most common ones for Five Nations are a. For Tuscarora, it's a. Okay, this is o or u or ga. Okay, so we've got the neuter, we've got the corn there, that's the thing there, and a noun suffix. It's really simple. Nouns are pretty simple. That's Josie Horn. You probably knew that. Okay, this one's for Lori. Okay, what's this?
Ohonada. Ohonada.
It's got the same structure, okay? It's got the prefix, it's got the potato, and it's got a noun suffix. And this is Jim Skye. Okay, verbs are really different. You really know they're really different. Okay.
Yabuyadawanadasid.
Sorry, so loud.
Yabuyadawanadasid.
Okay. They got lots of pieces. Okay, so this is a way, will, I, you, own voice insert for meaning. I'll call you. Okay. You see that, and you know it's a verb. Okay. Do this here.
Das Quaihasisa.
And tie it for me. Okay. What about particles? What are particles? They're little things that just don't have any structure, like Mohawk.
That's good.
Okay. Here we have this. They're very small. It's gone. Okay. So this is spontaneous Mohawk. Okay. Verb. That's like two sentences. Okay, they continue. I'll just show you this. Verb. Noun. Okay.
Wahati kwata aku ki o nomor kadero.
Verb. Okay. You can see that this is a hugely different mindset. Okay. So you don't just take English noun, you know, Iroquois noun, English verb, Iroquois verb. It's really a whole different way of organizing the world. Okay, they kept going. Okay, you see a pattern here. Okay, in just this conversation that you saw, just that part of it, there was one noun and there were 12 verbs. Okay, this is not unusual. I took a much bigger conversation and I just counted nouns and verbs. Okay, not translations, but what they really were in Mohawk. And for every noun, there were 17 verbs. Okay, this says something about translating word for word. It's not going to get to the real thing, is it? Okay, here's some kyuga. Okay, so back to his hunting fish. He says a lot of different ways to do it. Okay, this is how you hunt fish, a lot of different ways to do it. Verb. Okay, so I just looked through that whole discussion of the pike hunting, and we came out with 9 nouns, 161 verbs. Okay, how can they use so many verbs, you know? What's going on? Okay. Well, some things you just say with verbs if you're an Iroquois speaker, okay? And a lot of verbs have nouns inside of them, okay? So. She says, her car was parked on the other side of the street. Okay, you look at English, we've got noun, verb, maybe noun, okay. That's 2 verbs, okay? So this is a verb in structure, to be on the other side of, and this is the town, actually, and that's what you do with the other side of, and this is, you know, her car was parked there, okay, and you've got the car inside there, okay?
Twice on, do you help with?
And it's how you get he was wearing high boots. Okay. Now, as I said, a lot of verbs have nouns inside of them, so that lets you do a lot more with verbs. Okay. Big question here. We all know about noun incorporation, that you have all these nouns inside of verbs. Do good speakers just throw any old noun in there? Like, do you just sort of take an English sentence and take the nouns and throw them inside of the verbs, and you got good Mohawk or Cayuga or Onondaga or Tuscarora or Seneca? Well, no, actually. It's not random at all. Okay? As I said, words represent whole concepts, and speakers package whole concepts together in single words, but not just randomly sort of any old concepts. What goes inside of a word is part of a single idea for a speaker, or not just necessarily for that speaker, but for a whole culture. So if you look at what gets incorporated, this is a big part of heritage. It's how people, speakers, over thousands of years have packaged their experience into single words, which are single concepts. And we know concepts aren't the same from one language to the next. Okay, a lot of these things refer to customary activities. So a good example is actually this one. Okay. you know, why is the fish inside there? It's because fish hunting is a recognized cultural activity. Okay, and so if it were, you know, if he was going to say, this is how you hunt giraffes, he wouldn't have incorporated the giraffes for a lot of reasons. Let me count the ways. Okay, but yeah, he wouldn't have done that. Okay. And if you look around at, you know, just look at real speakers speaking, you'll see what they're doing. And some of it's, you know, berry picking. Okay, we all know about berry picking. You don't necessarily say, I was picking berries. It sounds berry picking, okay, and it goes together, okay. A lot of it's metaphorical. You'll understand, okay. How do you say you'll understand? Okay, you'll cause your mind to be setting. Your mind will come to set, okay. Mohawk. I mean, there's so many of these things. She's. How do you say she's listening? She's pricking her ears. Okay. How do you say they'll meet? This is a especially nice one. Okay. What? You know? Huh? What? This was about the band council meeting. Okay, and you can see that it's a concept. Okay, speakers know huge numbers of these. They know the ones that people use. This is idiomaticity. This is concepts. So it's not random. They're not just throwing anything in there. And a lot of them don't have the exact meaning of their parts. And this was brought up yesterday a number of times. So you can look and see, oh yeah, I see the pieces. But maybe you don't know what the whole thing means, like the pricking the ears or the kindling the fire. Okay, so can you talk by translation? Okay, so he said there's more than one way to express yourself. Imagine how you might say this in your language. Okay, here's how he said it. Okay, translation won't get you there. You know, you want to know about these kinds of things. Okay, now, convergence is a big deal that you want to think about. Okay, we talk about languages disappearing because the last first language speakers disappear. Okay, and that's very, very serious, and that's really with us. There's another more insidious thing that can happen, and that is, when you have bilingualism, it's a natural thing to think of an idea in one language and translate it literally into the other language, okay? And you gotta do that sometimes. I mean, we were talking about pizza this morning and pierogies and all that kind of stuff. Okay, how are you gonna do pizza? Well, maybe you can't look back at what they were doing in 1920 for pizza, so you gotta come up with new stuff. But you also wanna be aware of when you're creating things and when there's already a way of doing it, and do you want to sort of preserve some of the traditional mindset, or do you want to create new terms? And there's a place for each, but you want to know the difference, okay? So here, this was a group of people, some first language speakers, some second language speakers, all absolutely amazing, all fluent, okay? And we're talking about somebody that hadn't shown up that day, and she was very pregnant, and said, so anybody know anything about what's her name? And so one speaker said, I haven't heard anything. And here's how she said it. Okay, teina wagatunde. It's almost good. And I later asked a first language speaker what she would have said in that situation. And here's what she said. Okay. So it's very interesting. So if you're really looking to preserve every last detail of your heritage, you want to know about this stuff too. It's not necessarily going to be the same in Cayuga, not necessarily the same in Akwesasne as in Ganesadage or Gatnawage, but these are really precious things, ways of sort of seeing the world and expressing things. Okay, what's going on here? He has a runny nose. Okay, how do you say he has a runny nose? Ganyo Sadake, right? No! This was Kiyuga.
Ojin, growth.
Okay. Okay.
Ojin, growth.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, I mean, they're just ways people say things. And you want to do more than just say, okay, this is the nose part, the mucus part, and this is the stand part. You kind of want to have a record of this stuff, too. Okay, and of course, good speakers, first language speakers, they just do it. So you don't have to ask them, they just do it, okay? Speakers know full expressions, and they use them very skillfully to manage the flow of information. This is, again, this very special attention to what the listener is thinking and how they can take information in. Okay, so if you're first bringing something in new, okay, as we said, you put it at the beginning of the sentence, but also, this is when speakers tend to use a separate word for it. Okay, once it's established, then they can kind of work it into the verb, tuck it into the verb, because you don't have to keep saying, and I'm talking about this. Okay, you'll see what I mean here. Okay. So here's Kyuga, here's Reg again talking about hunting pike. He said, so, you know, all these ways to do this, and there was this other guy, you know, he just used a spear. Okay, this is the first time we've heard about spear. Okay, how do you say that? He's got a separate noun. That's a noun. You can see it's got the neuter on the front and the noun suffix on the back. So he's got a separate word for spear. It's the first time he's talked about a spear. He says, oh, yeah, they do this, they do this. And this guy, he just used a spear. Okay, so there's the spear as a separate word. It's also near the front, right, because it comes after the uses. Okay, but he'd been talking about a while. So I watched him get into the water right in the main stream. It was a little more than this. He's the guy that had the high-topped boots. The fish was going around in the water, and when it started to swim away, he speared it. Okay, here's how he said that. There's the spear tucked into the verb. How come he tucked it into the verb? We've already been talking about spears. Here's this guy, you know, when he's holding the spear, he's not going to say, and he caused it to lie with a spear. We got the spear in our minds, and so it's just tucked in there very, very delicately. And also, of course, this is one of those words that speakers know is a good form. So he didn't have to make this up. He sort of knew this as part of his understanding. Okay, how about this? Okay. They'd been on a trip from Gatnawage to Akwesasne, and they were talking about what they saw along the way. She says, oh, the corn's very short. It's been this dry summer. Okay, and here, she's got a separate word for the corn, that you saw the corn earlier. Okay, separate word. She hadn't talked, nobody talked about corn before. There it is at the beginning and in a separate noun. Okay. Oh, it seems like they're all doing poorly. Food's going to be expensive, and it's going to be a long time before we eat corn. There's the negi wahi. Okay. And she says, it's a long time before we're going to corn eat. Okay. Why did she tuck the corn into the verb? We were already talking about corn. It's already out there in our minds. So it's not like, and it'll be a long time before we eat corn. Okay. It's just tucked right in there. That's right. Okay, so what else is wrong with this picture? This is back to our sentence, our translated sentence. Particles. So remember, particles are those little things that just don't have anything inside. They're just one thing. Those are the particles here. Okay, you kind of notice a pattern. like they're all ne. Okay. And these are the ones that almost correspond to English the. In fact, they don't exactly correspond to English the. Ne gets used in slightly different ways from English the. Okay. But for the moment, it's in there because they're translating from English. You only use it in Mohawk if you're talking about something that's already been part of the discussion. Okay. What do particles do? Okay, this is the same for all the languages. They do everything. Okay, questions. Okay, you know that. Negatives. Place. Time. Contrast with expectation. Politeness. Degrees of certainty. Source of information. Relations among ideas. And this is only the tip of the iceberg. There's so much going on here. This, I should say, is a way that different Iroquoian languages differ. So they all use particles like crazy like this, but the particles are different, and even when the particles are the same, their uses are slightly different. So you think, you know, I've got this hooked for, I'm good on Mohawk, I'll just take my particles into Cayuga. Not actually quite true. So this is a way the languages differ. So they're very important in each of the languages, but what they do is subtly different. Okay, basically a big piece of particles is what the speaker thinks the listener is thinking. This is huge, it's really huge. Okay, and there's so much more. Okay, so here's Josie. She said, well, what I'd like to talk about is how odd the summer is. People have been talking about this. She says, I want to talk about, you know, this. Okay, got that. This is what she said. Sorry, the tape is bad. Everybody was talking at once. Okay. What do we have for particles here? The P's are particles. Okay. She could have said, oh, this is something else. So she was clowning around too. It was a lot of fun. She could have said, yeah, de waknego. I'm not drunk. Okay, she was really fun. Okay, she didn't say that. She said, yeah, ne de waknego. Okay, where's my cursor? Wait a second, there we go.
De waknego.
Okay, what difference does it make to put that ne in there? I don't know if any of you have a sense of why she did that. Interestingly, if you ask a speaker that, she's a very good speaker. If you ask a speaker, what's that ne? You know what she'd say? Oh, it doesn't really mean anything. You don't need it. Okay. What this means is, you were probably thinking I was drunk, but actually I wasn't. Okay. This is like, I'm thinking about what you're thinking, and I'm going to tell you that your thinking wasn't really right on track. And that's in that ne, okay? You can see this is a big deal, okay? Here's another one. They were talking about some land, and somebody was given some land, and he said, you let it go to seed. Here's what he said. How did he say it? Okay, look at those things. Those are particles. Okay, here's another one. She said, they think it's easy. How did she say it? Now imagine how you would say they think it's easy in your language. Okay, she wasn't translating. I'll show you what she said. Here's what she said. Okay, the redder particles. This is all about, here's how certain I am or not. Okay, maybe, but maybe not. What do you think? Isn't that so? This is all kinds of very careful monitoring of how certain I am, how I know things, what I think you're thinking. This is a huge piece of culture. Here's Reg again. Okay, so he says, we're back to this, how you hunt fish. So a lot of different ways they do it. Okay, and here's what he said. Okay, here's what it looks like. Those are his particles. Okay, he was just speaking spontaneously. None of this was written down or thought of beforehand. Look at the particles. I mean, my gosh, look at this. Okay, this, of course, this is the pike. Okay, it's actually a verb. It's got its long face right there. Anyway, okay, so I just looked at the Cayuga fish hunting you know, when he was talking about it, as I said, there were 9 nouns, 161 verbs. Guesses on how many particles he used? 262 particles. Okay, this is a big piece of the language, huge piece. Okay, and if you sort of look at each of these, and again, they're very different from one language to the next, how do you use them? Well, you look at how people interact, for example. So you'll find when people are asking questions in a real situation, you get a lot of you know, so how did she get her fortune told? And here's the answer. Did she go and get her fortune told? This is a conversation. Okay. Well, that's what she's saying. You'll see in these question-answer pairs, you get a lot of di in the questions and gi in the answers. The gi says, well, this is pertinent to what you were saying here. I mean, look at this fine sense of what people are thinking. Okay, and then there's finally another way that you guys all know that Iroquois languages are really, really special, and that's what people do with them. this is Reg. He says, okay, how do you say, how are you doing? Here's what he said. What did he really say? Okay, that's only a tiny little corner, a minuscule peek at what people do when they play with language. And good speakers do this like crazy. You were at this conversation. So I'll just play it for you. So Gayatri Thakkar had said, oh, and this is my friend Marianne, and we've been working on the language for all these many years, and she gave the number of years. And, you'll see what happened next. I don't know how many of you got that. Okay, what happened? So she just said how many years we've been working together. And she says, we were just little children when we started working on this to explain that we're not really very old. And so he says, oh, now you have a big plate. Okay, this is a play on words. We were just little children. There's the child root. And he says, now you have big. And he put this one in. Okay, look at him playing with the language. It's beautiful, and good speakers just do this all the time. Okay, and there are reasons people do it. I mean, I think one reason is this language has so many tools, so much equipment for letting you do this kind of stuff. I mean, these languages are extraordinary. But then there's another piece of it, and this is culture. This is heritage. So I've worked with other communities in North America with really interesting languages, but I've never seen this kind of awareness and pride and appreciation and tradition of nurturing this kind of artistry that I've seen with Iroquois languages. Specialness of Iroquois languages. Okay, you know, they're not just another way of saying the same thing. It's not just use this sound instead of that sound, and you really know that. These languages embody different ways of categorizing experience. So, you know, when you're born, it's not like you have all the categories in the world. It's like it's this big kind of blur. And one of the things language does is tell you what the pieces are, what the concepts are, what the ideas are, and that's vocabulary, and that's something that's really a big, big piece of heritage, okay? Relating ideas, okay, you've seen how, like in the question answer, so this is a question, so how does it, oh, well, let me pertain to that, this is how that goes, okay? And relating, interacting with other people. And this doesn't happen. You might say, well, where do these little pieces come from? Where do the prefixes and suffixes come from? We know where they come from. They're not just random. It's not like just, oh, if you want to speak an Iroquoian language, just take the spaces out and you've got good stuff. No. These prefixes and suffixes are the result of what people have said the most often over thousands and thousands of years. If you say something very, very often, you start to routinize it, and it gets smaller. So, like, think about riding a bike, okay? You first get on that bike, and you're doing this kind of stuff to stay upright. Okay, I'm moving that way, I gotta move this way, you know, okay. Once you're good at it, you're not doing this anymore, you're not even thinking about it, okay. The movements are very, very small, and that's what's happened with these languages. The things that are now prefixes and suffixes are things that people have said so often, have chosen to say so often, that they're now right there in part of the tradition, in part of the grammar, okay. So for example, Iroquoian speakers found it was important to distinguish two people from three or more people. Okay, so you have a dual in Iroquoian language. You don't have that in English. Okay, people were busily doing that, but you notice you've got this like ni and radi, etc. Okay, you don't do that for animals, right? Well, it depends on the animal, actually. You don't do it for rocks. So if you want to say, you know, this is a rock. You don't say, and that's two rocks. If you want to say, and that's two rocks, you have to use a whole other digony or whatever. Okay, because people didn't care about the difference between two rocks and three rocks, but you do care a lot about the difference between, you know, there were two of us or there were lots of us. Okay, so the point of this is this grammar is just not kind of an arbitrary different way of pronouncing things. This holds sort of a record of what people have said over thousands and thousands of years. Conceptualizing things, okay, and notice so many more verbs than nouns, okay, people think about in terms of actions, events, states, not just stuff, okay, carefully managing the flow of information. So Iroquoian speakers are constantly aware, maybe not aware at the top of their minds, but certainly in their speech about what their listeners know already and what's going to be new and interesting. They know how to package things together in a single word versus focusing on it with a separate word. So you've got noun incorporation and specifying relations among ideas and managing interpersonal relationships with particles. Okay, and strong traditions of cherishing, appreciating, enjoying, nurturing verbal skill and artistry. This is really special. Okay, so what do you do to protect and appreciate this rich heritage? Okay, it means you don't want to just translate, obviously. I mean, at the beginning, that's going to be useful. But you want to sort of get to know what's really special. And there's so much to know that's special, what skilled speakers really do. So what's the priority? It's exactly what you guys are already doing. You continue to converse with first language speakers as much as you possibly can, because you're going to see how they put ideas into concepts, how they manage their particles, okay? And you don't want to say, okay, what's the translocative here? That's not what speakers are supposed to know. You know, you watch it happen. Let them do what they're doing. Yeah, I mean, some speakers who become linguists can do this. But, you know, so why did you have a falling tone on that? Oh, right, I'm sorry, I didn't notice there was an H before a resonant. Okay, no, that's not how you spend time with speakers. Okay, let them do what they do. Talk to each other in a variety of situations. That came up again this morning. Okay, I'm finishing here. On a variety of topics, because you have everybody doing the same thing all the time, you only get a small piece of vocabulary. If you have people doing different things, you're going to have a much nicer picture. Okay, that's it. In show.